from beyond the Beltway. This is Bruce DuMont with our weekly analysis of national politics with occasional injections of rumor and innuendo, all offered up by our panel of political insiders, pundits, power brokers, public servants, and most importantly, plain-speaking Americans from coast to coast. Tonight, featuring commentary by Philip Beverly from the University of Illinois, Mike Miller, economist from DePaul University, and Republican attorney Judith Sherwin from Chicago. Our program coming to you from our home base at AM 560 WIND in beautiful Elk Grove Village, Illinois. Our phone lines open at 1-800-723-8289. That's 1-800-723-8289. And again, we've got lots of things to talk about. The president's obviously visit to the Middle East and that famous fist bump heard around the world. But I want to begin with a story that's really breaking really in America right now, and that is the Texas House this afternoon came out with their report on the shooting in Vivaldi and the actions of the police department there. They have relieved the acting head of police at the school as one result of this report. But what the report said, they said a lot. There's been a press conference going on throughout the day. They said, quote, when they're talking about the actions of the police, they failed to prioritize saving the lives of innocent victims over their own safety. That's what the report said about the actions of the law enforcement officers. And again, the local newspaper down there, the Statesman, Austin Statesman, and the local television station, they had released some video footage of the actions inside the school by the police department. And you clearly see the police department backing away after that first shot was heard from the assailant in this particular case. And a lot of people who support law enforcement all over the country perhaps were a little bit chagrined or really upset about that. Certainly the parents of the victims are very upset at the actions of the police department in that area. And we should also mention that there were federal and there were state authorities that were also involved in there. Most of the focus of this attention has been on the actions of the local police department. So I want to get just a reaction from all of our guests. It isn't the main topic this evening. Judith Sherwin joins me in studio. Mike Miller joins us from Bellingham, Washington. And Phil Beverly joins us from Burlington, Vermont. So we're taking the pulse all over the country this evening. But I want to begin with you, Phil. What's your reaction to what you saw? Obviously, it's too early to maybe have read the entire report, but how badly did law enforcement act? And had you been a law enforcement officer, would you have been going after the assailant worried about your own life, or would you have been more heroic, as some people suggest that the police department there should have been?
I think that the major failing here, Bruce, is actually in leadership. And I think that trickles down to there wasn't the leadership that would have informed the law enforcement officers at the lower level to go in and do what was necessary. I mean, the FBI has been training this way and training law enforcement agencies all over the country since after Columbine, that you don't wait, you go in and you engage the shooter. It's an immediate thing. And so something failed, and I don't think it's the training, because everybody's had the training. Something failed in leadership that they didn't have that messaging to go in and do what was right. And I think that they really need to take a look at leadership all right, the way up through those agencies that were involved. Okay.
Judith Sherwin joins me in studio here. Judith, your response.
Well, I was listening to the report on the way here, and I would agree that there was a massive failure of leadership. But there, it was not just the Uvalde Police Department. I mean, there were federal agencies there. There were state agencies there. I mean, don't these classrooms have windows? It just, I don't understand why they didn't do more to try to engage the shooter. Why nobody engaged the shooter at all. They were standing around in the hallway using hand sanitizer. I mean,
one officer.
One officer. Yeah. Well, okay. But you know, They were in the building. They never even tried to get in the classroom. This business about going for a key is bizarre. So it the whole thing is it's astounding to the rest of us watching this. I mean, you always hope that when you're presented with a situation like that, you are going to act with courage. These people did not.
Mike Miller, your reaction from Bellingham, Washington.
Yeah, I think Phil said it so very well. I'm not an expert in law enforcement. And I did read the thing that Phil, I think, focused upon, which I think is very important, is after Columbine, it became clear that you can't stand by and let this happen. That if anything else, I mean, the person who would be shooting will be shooting at you instead of at the students or the people who would be the victims here. And that would give them a chance maybe to either escape or to hide better or something like that. And so I think the fact that they did have the training, they should have known better. I don't know how I would respond, but I guess if I'm one who would be in law enforcement, I would always know that the chance could happen, that I'm going to have to be in a very precarious situation where my life might be at stake. And if I'm not willing to handle that, then I don't think I should be a police officer at all. I mean, Philip, you were in the military, right? You knew that there was always the chance that something could go wrong. And so you, that's part of the gig. And so I'm disappointed. Of course, though, if I could just add one more little piece, it does happen in a town I've never heard of before, Uvalde, Texas. Phil, had you ever heard of Uvalde, Texas before
never
that? And so who knows if it was some little town, like I'm right next to a town called Linden, Washington. What would the Linden police do? I don't know. I don't want to be too judgmental, but there certainly was a failure in leadership.
But here, I think what's happening is around the country, I think there is a feeling of judgment that's going on. And I would like to hear if we have anyone who's in law enforcement watching or listening to the program this evening, I would love to hear from your perspective, because I think many in the general public are thinking, as we have articulated tonight, is that these police officers, they cowered. They didn't do the heroic thing. Now, they want to come back and to their families at night. I would hope that I would have done the right thing, especially if I'm part of a group to sort of storm the shooter in this particular case. But I can't say that I would do it unless I'm, you know, even if I was trained for it, I don't know whether I could do it. I should do it, but I'd like to get sense. I'd like to know how deep this feeling and this second guessing of the police force in Vivaldi, I'd like to know how widespread it is. Judith?
Yeah, I mean, in other situations, I believe in the Sandy Hook situation, the police went in, confronted the shooter, and they killed him, all right? And he probably could have done more damage than he did. For some reason, this police force, with all their guns and all their stuff and all their bulletproof vests and whatever training they had, just couldn't get it together to do that. And I agree with what everybody else has said. This is a massive failure of leadership and understanding what the role should have been.
We've got a pause. 1-800-723-8029. If you'd like to weigh in on that. If not, we'll be back with other topics.
Oh, hello. You know, these days, I'm often quoted as saying, you can't believe everything you read on the internet. People forget that I was the first technology president using the telegraph, T-mails as I like to call them, to communicate with my generals. Well, today, we are fighting a cybersecurity war, and our best defense is for folks to follow some of these tips when they're online. If it seems too good to be true, it probably is. Hover your cursor over links to determine the true web address. Look for misspellings and poor grammar, which are warning signs of fraud. Be suspicious of emails requesting urgent action, and never give away sensitive personal information. With malware for none, with cyber protection for all, this is your humble servant, Abraham Lincoln.
The central and midwestern U.S. averages more than 850 tornadoes each year. And lately, the number of floods has been rising in the region, too. So chances are, there will be more twisters and floods near here again. And between school, sports, and social lives, chances are, you won't be with your kids when it happens. Will they know what to do? Ready.gov/kids has all the educational tools and information to make the conversation easy. When the time comes, chances are, they'll feel prepared, not scared. So talk with your family today.
Bruce DuMont back on Beyond the Beltway. Thanks very much. We just saw, for those watching on television and YouTube, we saw beautiful Mount Baker in Washington. And Mike Miller, that's not too far from where you live. And thank you very much for sending in that beauty shot of your neighborhood. How far is Mount Baker from where you live?
It's 5 miles. But what you see is what I see each day that it's clear. It's 10,700 feet tall. And covered with snow pretty much the year round. And quite gorgeous.
Next time we have you on, we're going to make that your background, like you're reporting from the base of Mount Baker. But again, by the way, I've mentioned this before. If you would like to send us pictures from your hometown, some beautiful pictures, more and more people are starting to do that. Send it to BruceDuMont1944@gmail.com. Please make a note of, obviously, who you are, but also make a note of the picture. Give us a little description of the picture as well. We continue with our discussion, and now back to basically some of the prime topics that we wanted to talk about this evening. And, Mike Miller, I want to begin with you, as we did last month when you were on. Give us your update on all the major economic stories that popped this week, your reaction to some of these new reports, and are things getting better or are they getting worse for the American people?
You know, I've been at this over 40 years, and I've never seen data quite like what we have right now. We have a situation where we have the lowest unemployment, the strongest labor market pretty much ever, which is a very, very impressive. At the same time, we have a decline in gross domestic product. But here's what the other part is. You know, GDP can be measured either from the expenditure side, people spending, or from the income side. And for the first time, the income is showing an increase in the economy and the expenditures are showing a decrease. And if you look at manufacturing, you see that industrial production has slowed. But when you look at it across the board, all companies are reporting that they're still expanding. They're still growing. So I've never seen an economy that seems to be to have such conflicting information, that you could have a declining gross domestic product with the strongest labor market on record. The interest rates are rising, and there's no doubt that the economy is going to slow because of it. But here's one thing: I follow what the Fed does, and they're not forecasting a recession, and it's not because they're rosy scenario. They have some very good economists who are doing very decent forecasts. But I also follow a local bank economist in the Chicago region. I don't want to give his name, but he is not forecasting a recession. He says the underlying labor market is strong enough that we're going to somehow get through this crazy period and survive without a recession. Now, I'm not going to pull a Bill Maher and say, well, I'm going to hope for a recession so that our guys get in, that Republicans get, you know, elected in November. I would never do something so horrible. But I can say that the economy is showing some definite stress. There is some problems within the economy, while at the same time, we have an economy unlike any other when it comes to the labor market.
Phil Beverly, a question to Phil Beverly. Phil Beverly, you're our card-carrying Democrat this evening. Has the Biden administration done a good job, a bad job, or an adequate job in explaining sort of the uniqueness of this economic situation we're in, as Mike Miller has just described?
I think the job is sort of inadequate because I think what they're relying on is sort of rationality. And I think the people that are being most impacted by the inflation rates and where the economy is sort of skewing negatively, aren't thinking about it rationally. They're looking at bottom line issues like my groceries cost X percent more than they did this time last year. Gas cost more than X percent this time last year. And so being rational about why we might or might not go into a recession, I don't think is going to resonate with them. And I think that's sometimes the problem with my party is that we don't speak sometimes in a way that connects with people in where they're at, if that makes sense. And I did have a question for Mike. So you haven't seen this in like 40 years of looking at economic indicators and performance and that. Is this really pretty much attributable to that once in a century thing, like a global pandemic?
It certainly could be. And you know, one of the big debates, of course, recently has been who caused the inflation. And the Republicans want to say it was Joe Biden and all of his spending, which, by the way, he made it so much harder by having all of this spending where he borrowed the money. But ultimately, when it comes down to inflation is the purview of the Federal Reserve. And the Federal Reserve, since it wanted to keep interest rates low, Joe Biden pushed them into a corner. The only way to keep interest rates low was for the Fed to buy all of that debt. And which means we printed money to finance the debt. Mm-hmm. And that is what's, in some sense, the engine of all the inflation we're seeing. So Joe Biden was partly responsible, but it's ultimately on the backs of the Fed for allowing this to occur and not getting ahead of the inflation. They did not think it was going to be this bad. Lawrence Summers, a Democrat, a brilliant, by the way, a brilliant economist, a bit of a jerk as a person, but a brilliant economist. He told them, he said, guys, you can't be spending this kind of money and borrowing this kind of money without having inflation. Now, I'll tell you that one thing that's kind of upsetting is that Lawrence Summers believes we're not going to get out of this period without having unemployment approach 6% plus. And that would be a really bad, situation if that were the case.
Judith Sherwin's have been waiting to jump into this.
Yes, Judith? Thank you. All this talk about the economy and the economists and everybody's theories, you've got 9.1% inflation. As Phil pointed out, you have people going to the gas pump. The prices are a little bit down now, but they are, at least 100% more than they were this time last year in most places. Food is more. Getting on an airplane is more. Everything that anybody wants, going to the movies is more. And at the same time, people's wages are stagnant or they are down. That amounts to something like I was reading the other day, something like a 15% tax increase on people, okay? Their money is going much less far than it went before. So all this talk about whether there's going to be an inflation or the Fed, I agree, you can't be printing all this money and expect everything is going to turn out all right. And you can't have Janet Yellen sitting there saying, gee, I made a mistake. Yeah, you made a big mistake. And people, regular people, who I hope are going to go to the polls and ask for some different policies, are suffering for it right now. And
what
we need to do something about it.
What policies are they going to ask for? What is the Republican alternative policy-wise, to what's going on right now?
Well, first of all, I think, this fixation on the Green New Deal is going to stop. This business about the energy situation is going to stop. We're going to try to bring a halt to it. I mean, we're not going to have the presidency, right? Please, we hope the Republican Party hopes they're going to have the House. And they also hope they're going to have the Senate. That should be able to put some brake on the president, who, of course, announced today that since he can't get Joe Manchin to go along with him, he's going to start writing executive orders. I don't know what executive orders that would be. He doesn't really have the power to make the Build Back Better, whatever it is, by himself.
Mike Miller, what's your answer to the question about what is it that the Republicans could be saying?
What can the Republicans do? Let me answer one thing about Judy said, wages are rising. They're just not rising fast enough to deal with this very, very high inflation. So in real terms, wages are falling. Even though people do have more dollars to take home, they won't go as far. Right. But the key to this is, and I've seen this both on the, by the way, on the Democratic side of Democratic economists as opposed to Republican economists, a lot of people are arguing what we need is a supply push. In other words, you can, inflation is too many dollars chasing too few goods. One thing is to get rid of the too many dollars. The other is to produce more goods. And so anything that Joe Biden could do with Congress to try to stimulate the production of more energy, more goods, to move the ports faster and transport things more quickly, to get the supply side growing more quickly, would by its very nature reduce the pressures of inflation over time.
But you're also you've also got the price of oil, which influences just about everything.
That is correct.
And
which has become, along with other commodities.
Right.
Look at commodities. Copper is one, for example, that's very telling. When copper's price goes down, the economy's in trouble. Copper's price is down. Mm-hmm. The price of commodities across the board are down. That's why a lot of economists on both sides of the aisle, who have politics affect their decision making, are arguing that inflation, we believe, has peaked. It's still going to stay higher than it should be, and the Fed's still going to have to fight it, and interest rates are still going to go up. But I'm hoping that the worst is behind us, and that that we will see this continual drop, slow drop in inflation without necessarily falling into recession. It would be the first time, by the way. We've never gotten out of this situation before. It's called a soft landing, where you take an overheated economy, you raise interest rates, and you get the economy to slow without a recession. Fed has never pulled that off under these conditions.
We've got to pause.
Pulled it off under less inflation, but not under this much inflation.
I'm hoping
that the Fed can do it this time.
When we come back, I want to bring Phil Beverly into the conversation again and ask for his reaction, the first reaction, to the president's trip to the Middle East and the famous fist bump seen around the world. How upset is he with that fist bump? I'm Bruce Dumont. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Roll down the windows, turn up the radio, and discover all that Illinois has to offer. Find your road trip at enjoyillinois.com.
Back, and again, for those watching us this evening, Lake Champlain, right, in Vermont. Phil Beverly sent that in addition to the beautiful shot that he is using behind him this evening. How far is that from where you live, Phil? Your visit, we should mention, you're visiting.
Down the road about 5 minutes.
5 minutes away. Can we show that picture one more time? That beautiful picture, Lake Champlain, Vermont. Boy, oh boy. And you're going to be in Vermont for a while? You're sort of summer vacationing there at the moment?
Sort of back and forth to Chicago as we sort of get settled here.
Okay. Next time you're on, I want to know how they elect a Republican governor in that state.
that's gonna be a difficult,
very liberal Republican, but again, he's a Republican. Phil, I said I'm going to go to you first. What grade would you give the president on his recent trip to the Middle East and Saudi Arabia?
I guess there's no permanent friends, only permanent interests. Mm-hmm. And I don't, this is politically, this is not obviously personally.
Right.
I don't like the Saudis. I don't like dealing with the Saudis. Really don't like dealing with MBS. And we have to, because the bigger threat in that region of the world is Iran. And we have to work with the Saudis to deal with Iran not getting nuclear weapons and delivery systems. That would destabilize that region in a way that is intolerable to that region and the world. So that he, you know, I think he just held his nose and did what he had to do. I got to give my hats off to him, because I don't know that I would be able to smile and fist bump the guy. I just don't know.
Judith Sherwin, the news media is reporting that everybody's upset about the fist bump. Who are the people that are upset about the fist bump?
I don't know. It looked kind of stupid.
Neither do I.
Okay. It just didn't look dignified. You know, I mean, this is the president of the United States meeting with the Saudi prince, you know, the crown. I mean, you just don't do that. It's just not
Why
the
not?
Way. Because it's not dignified. It's not befitting his office. It's not befitting who he's
but
with.
But we need their oil.
Absolutely. But fist bumping isn't going to do it. The way you get their oil and the way you get their attention, for those of us who've been in the Middle East, you have to show some strength to these people, or they're not interested in dealing with you. They don't take your phone calls, which they were not doing with him earlier this year. So, I
but
mean, the
about,
fist
but,
bump
no,
is, a,
what,
is an example of, I mean, it's ridiculous. That's all. But I looked at it and I kind of went,
would,
okay.
Would a handshake be different?
Yes, a handshake would be different.
Would a bow be different?
Bow, he shouldn't bow. You don't bow. We don't bow.
Okay. Obama bowed.
We don't bow. Okay.
Okay. Mike Miller, what about the brouhaha over the fist bump? How important was it, and what signal does it have?
I didn't get it. I didn't see what the issue was. I do think a handshake is more formal and more gentlemanly and so forth, but I didn't get to, you know, two guys, they meet each other, they fist bump. Why not? I'm not sure I understand exactly why there's such a discussion about it. I'm more concerned two things which I wish we could have gotten out of there. Some kind of, since we have decided to squander our own self-reliance upon oil, then what we should have done is try to ask for more oil. And according to their foreign minister or whatever, he said, or their oil minister, Biden never asked for oil. He never asked them to pump more. And the second thing is, I wish that he would have brought up the Abraham Accords and said, I'd like to see more direct statement that you support the existence of Israel, and it is a bulwark against Iran. I think Phil is spot on as to in terms of Bahrain and the UAE and Saudi and so forth. You've got to have this united front against Iran becoming a world power.
But they do have, Mike, they did have the announcement that air travel between Israel and Saudi Arabia was open to Muslims.
Yep,
which
I think that's
that
great.
New.
I just think, you know, it become more prominent. I just like to see that normalizing the talking about Israel as though it's any other country. I think that would be a heck of a breakthrough for that part of the world. But it would also, I think, again, Phil's point about focusing upon Iran, there's got to be somebody who stands up against Iran.
Phil, is this more, are Democrats more upset with Joe Biden on this than Republicans? That's the way I'm sort of getting it.
I think what they're upset is, the upset is around the Jamal Khashoggi issue, and is that being pushed publicly? I mean, if he brings it up publicly, it creates embarrassment for the crown prince, right? If they work the back channel and bring it up that way, that's probably a better way to maintain relationships there. But I think Democrats wanted to see something about, and I don't know what the something is, I don't, but wanted to see something about, you need to be strong on human rights. And I think that's a heavy lift for any president in that area of the world.
And I would say any president ever. I mean, you know, we sometimes expect that, you know, when a president goes to meet with, you know, North Korea or whoever, we're supposed to stand up, wave the flag of human rights, and not worry about whether or not we're going to insult another former leader or national leader, who in the case of North Korea could be planning to nuke South Korea. I mean, we as a nation have got to swallow hard, and in this particular case, I mean, there are many people in the country that seem to be more concerned about some sort of justice out of the Khashoggi murder, and it was a murder. They're more concerned about that than whether or not we can make a deal on oil and have our oil prices go down. Well, the average American, I think, is more concerned about the latter, not the former.
Well, and I think, you know, if the Democrats are upset with him because he didn't come in and wave the human rights flag, I mean, it didn't get any oil either. All right. So
As far as we know, come later. There's been a hint.
Well, there's been a hint that they were going to release more oil in 2027. It's not going to help us right now, right? And so I think that and the other thing about this business with the airspace, you know, their foreign minister came out and said, this doesn't mean anything. We're letting them go across the airspace, and it's no indication that we're going to do anything else. But I do think that what has happened in the Middle East, and it's something that the last administration was able to exploit, is Iran has frightened everybody to death, and including the Saudi prince. And so I think we have to learn how to use that card to our benefit. Okay. But Biden went there, and except for the fist bump, I'm not exactly sure what he got out of this trip. He didn't make the Democrats very happy, and he hasn't done anything about the oil either. So here we are, not to mention that under our feet in this country, we have more oil than the Saudis have, and for some reason, their oil is better than our oil in terms of climate change. I mean, it's irrational. It makes no sense.
Mike Miller, to you, why is that not apparently a more viable political issue for Republicans than it appears to be right now? I mean, are they waiting? Is that going to come out in the midterms? I'm just saying is that, I mean, you're right. I mean, on day one, he kills the pipeline.
Yes,
you know,
he
we're in need of oil, and we're going halfway around the world to beg for oil. To a despot when we have it. But my question to you is, Mike Miller, I mean, the president is saying that the oil companies, which have the right to drill in certain areas, not as much as they perhaps would like to, he is saying the oil companies are gouging the American people, and they should take fewer profits.
No,
they've used that before, and at some reason, oil companies don't gouge all the time. They only wait until periods like this. I mean, the price gouging thing is a silly argument.
Not to mention the gas station owners.
He went after fracking from the very first day.
I mean, the gas station owners are supposed to be gouging the public. These are the smallest of the small business people with the narrowest of profit margins. That's obnoxious to say that.
We were energy self-sufficient. We have more natural gas. We have something like 250 years of natural gas, even assuming an increase in use. Natural gas is, if you're going to use fossil fuel at all, it's probably one of the most, the cleanest of the fossil fuels. And I think that the Republicans are correct that in their reading that these high prices for energy are exactly what Mr. Biden and the Democrats want.
Absolutely.
They want us to move away from fossil fuels into alternatives, and they want us to drive very expensive electric vehicles that some want and some don't want. I think that's what they need to play up in the midterms, because we've squandered having energy efficiency, energy under our control.
Right.
Phil,
agree.
I tried to interrupt. Mike was... He was on a roll. He was getting extra money for his words. When we come back, I'm going to let you respond, and you'll present the case as to why the Democrats really don't want all this all these electric cars, okay? You'll be up from beautiful Vermont, one of the most beautiful states in the United States. If you've never been there, try it out. I'm Bruce DuMont, back shortly from Chicago, also not so bad.
Stand is precise, no margin for error.
Dare to forget that. Dare to have fun with it. Get weird with it. Dare to send those old STEM theories flying past the neighbor's house into outer space. Dare to program something internet-breaking, record-breaking. Dare to blow their minds. Dare to learn the difference between sedimentary and metamorphic rock. Go find those rocks. Dare to keep daring. Dare to STEM. Check out She Can STEM to get started. With instant acceleration, electric cars are more fun to drive and more affordable than ever. Electric cars are here. Plug in to the present.
Back, we do have a note here from Ron Babcock, who is a regular viewer and listener of this program, and he writes, a police officer is not expected to lay down his life for $47,000 a year. A police officer has a very dangerous job and sometimes dies in the line of duty because of things he can't foresee or control. But generally, a police officer is supposed to find a way to enforce the laws without killing himself. In addition, the police have to do their job in a way that does not endanger the lives of others. In many places, they can't engage in high-speed chases in heavily populated areas. Moreover, they have to know where every bullet will end up. So that's Ron Babcock's response to our opening conversation this evening, and that is for those that are second-guessing the actions of the Uvalde, Texas police officers. Again, there was a report that came out today. It'll be on all the newscasts this evening about a Texas House investigation, which comes down very hard on the Uvalde Police Department and suggesting that they cared more about their own personal safety than they did about saving and preserving innocent lives. I'm going to come back to you, Phil Beverly. I asked the question before the break, so you're up. You're on. Remember the question?
I hope we're not in a space where we're debating whether climate change is happening, because it is, and we're contributing to it. The thing about the whole electric car thing is, the irony is, cars don't contribute that much to the greenhouse gas effect that we're seeing with climate change. It's sort of the least of the contributors, and yet we're spending a lot of time, and electric cars aren't going to be necessarily green. They could be clean, but they may not be green, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. It makes perfect sense.
I think that we're going to have to deal with climate change, and we're going to have to do something about fossil fuels. And I just got to say, I hate to say it, I'm thinking like down the road for our country, like maybe two or three generations from now, when I'm not even here, we're still going to need petroleum, not to burn in engines or whatever, but we're still going to need to use it to make plastics, for example. It's going to be necessary. I'd rather burn somebody else's right now and burn mine at the end of the game.
How do you respond to those, many of whom are Republicans, who basically say the president made a huge mistake when he cut the Keystone pipeline, and that he's put handcuffs on the American oil company from digging and making and coming up with more oil at a time when we're becoming more reliant on foreign oil. This after several years when we were less reliant on them during the Trump administration. If not totally reliant, some would argue that we were totally reliant. There's some question about the totality of that. But again, was that wise? Does that not send a signal, again, to the average American who may not be an environmentalist, that this doesn't make any sense? If we're not maximizing the facilities and the resources of the United States for Americans, what's wrong? Why would we not be doing that? And what is the Democrat answer to that?
Well, we've got two things happening, and one of them is we're going to have to address climate change. We're going to have to do that. And if we're saying that the EPA doesn't have the authority to do that, then the president's going to use whatever's in the toolkit to get that done. And if it's shutting down a pipeline and sending a signal to oil companies that you're going to have to make some other investments in energy, you're going to need to stop being oil companies and start being energy companies, which is a huge transition. I get from a business perspective, you have to stick to your sort of core function and all that. And I think it's going to require some transformation of those companies.
Judith Sherwin, I ask you, and then we're going to Mike. What is the conservative Republican position on climate change? Do you believe it or not?
I don't want to get into a debate on climate change, and I'm not going to do it.
Well, what's your opinion?
My opinion is that we've been hearing about climate change for the last 50 years. We're not even supposed to be here now. New York is supposed to be underwater. Miami is supposed to be underwater. And it hasn't happened. So is there something that we are doing to the environment that could be dangerous for us? I'm sure there is. But a return to the Stone Age is not exactly what we need. Using firewood to heat your house, which many people are going to have to resort to this coming winter in Germany, is not exactly something that we really want to do. All right. So the question of what to do, if using oil in this country to run your car is not good using American oil, why is it okay to use Saudi oil? Or why is it okay to use Venezuelan oil? It's not, okay? And their oil isn't even as refined or as clean as our oil is and made up to our standards to protect the environment. So that makes zero sense. And this business I just like to finish this about the electric cars. Yeah, the electric cars are not going to save humanity. But when Pete Buttigieg gets on the radio or wherever he was and says with that smirk that he walks around with that it's a wonderful thing that the price of oil is so high because it's encouraging people who can't afford to put gas in their car to go out and spend $50,000 on a new car that's an electric car, that is lunacy.
Okay? When did he say that? I can't believe it.
When did he say it? He said it 2 days ago. I can
with a smirk, I'd love to see it.
With a smirk.
With a smirk on his
absolutely.
Face.
Absolutely.
Mike Miller. We want
obnoxious.
Mike, I've got 30 seconds for you right now. Give me the short version of whether you believe climate change or not. Just 30 seconds.
I believe that the, is climate changing? Yes, I believe that the climate is changing. Do I think that humans have added to it? Yes, I think that's the case. But I'm not in any way convinced that it's linear. And therefore, I think we're not talking about the end of the world. We just have to make some adjustments as we've always done in the past.
Okay.
And making those adjustments would be the key.
Okay, Mike Miller, Phil Beverly, and Judith Sherwin, they're all coming back for hour number two. Phone lines open, 1-800-723-8289. This is Beyond the Beltway. I'm Bruce Dumont.
Roll over.
Chance high five. All right.
When you adopt a shelter pet, you discover all the things that make them unique.
And your mother.
I am totally a hot person. Right, guys? Thanks for being honest. They're a little bit of a lot of things, but they're all pure love. Adopt pure love at theshelterpetproject.org.
Dallas, St. Louis, Nashville, Tuscaloosa.
all major cities to feel the destruction caused by a direct hit from a tornado. Is Chicago next? It's not a question of if, but when, and the clock is ticking. Learn what to do now at ready.illinois.gov to become tornado ready.
Type 2 diabetes can have a big impact on your life, but how can it be prevented? Well, the first step is knowing if you have prediabetes, a serious medical condition that puts you at high risk for type 2 diabetes. One in three American adults has prediabetes, but more than 80% don't know they have it. The good news is, prediabetes can be reversed, and for many people, healthy changes in their daily routine can make a big difference. Take the 1-minute risk test today at doihaveprediabetes.org.